Grace and peace to you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, and good morning. My name is Greg, and I am the pastor here at Salem First Presbyterian Church, and it is my joy to welcome you this March 17th, 2024. Spring seems to have sprung, at least for the last couple days, which is exciting. I don't know about you, but I'm sore because I was working in my yard yesterday, which I have more yard work to do tomorrow or today after church. Anyway, Salem First Presbyterian Church is a full inclusion community of ordinary people experiencing and embodying God's extraordinary love. And we believe you have a place here, whether you are here in person, whether you're joining us online. We are so thankful that you have taken a moment out of your week to be here. And every week at this time, we gather for worship, and we gather and we remember that everyone has the light of Christ in them. And we light this candle as a visual reminder of the way that Christ's light shines within each one of us. This small candle and this small light gives us just a brief glimpse of what it means to have joy and purpose and life in this world. We also know that when a flame is matched with another flame, it does not diminish but increases the light. And so we gather in this community, we gather online, we gather not in this building but also out in the community, remembering that as the light is combined, the warmth grows and the brightness grows. So we gather in this moment at this time to remember that Christ is with us. Christ lives with us, works with us, is there when we're a little cranky, and is there when we can bask in the sun and be thankful for the soreness that the opportunity to work provides. I'd like for you to take a deep breath, focusing your energy on this moment, on this space, all that you come with, everything that is on your mind. It is here, and it is welcome, and it is loved. It might not all be healthy, it might not all be beautiful, but it is loved, and we accept all that comes with you and in this space, and we seek help and healing with God and one another as we share our love of Christ. And now I invite you to rise as you feel led and join us in our first song. Thank you.
Amen. You may be seated. Good morning and welcome to Salem First Presbyterian Church. My name is Kim and I am the director of Reconnect Ministry. We are a full inclusion community of ordinary people experiencing and embodying God's extraordinary love, and we want you to know that you have a place here. Irrespective of your faith journey, your race, your orientation, or any characteristics by which some might attempt to disvalue you. If you would like to know more about our congregation or get involved in some way, we invite you to join us after service in the fellowship hall, which is just on the other side of the windows here. And you can grab a bite to eat and some coffee or tea and visit the folks that are at the Welcome Center there. If you are joining us online, we invite you to visit our website, salemfpc.org, or you can send any questions to engage@salemfpc.org, and we will get back to you. Again, welcome, and we are glad that you are here. We do invite you to join us, again, in the fellowship hall immediately after service for our cookie potluck. Come taste all the different kinds of cookies that everyone brought to share. After we eat a few cookies, the middle and high school age youth are invited to take part in the Salem Youth Collective event happening today. We'll head over to St. Paul's Episcopal Church and have some lunch and spend the afternoon doing various things like tree planting and creating prayer flags for healing and peace. So come find me or Ashley after service if you'd like to join in on the fun. Coming up next weekend, March 22nd is the fourth Friday, so that means Parents' Night Out. Parents, you can drop your kids off between 5 and 8 p.m. and go do something fun while they have a great time here playing with their friends together at the church. We could use a few more volunteers, so if you'd like to volunteer, you could find Gwen, or if you don't know who Gwen is, I can point you out to her. Find me and I'll point you out to her. I think you all know who Gwen is. Next Sunday, also then, March 24th, there's no youth group because we will have our young adult group. So if you are ages 18 to roughly 25-ish, join us at 5:30 p.m. for a time of dinner and fellowship with other young adults. And then Holy Week begins March 24th with Palm Sunday. And then we have Maundy-Thursday service, which will be March 28th at 5:30 p.m. Our Good Friday service will be March 29th at 5:30 p.m. And then on Easter Sunday, we're going to have two services. So our traditional morning service will take place at the usual time of 10:30 a.m. And then we will have an evening service at 5:30 p.m. that will involve a meal. Also, the collective churches around the area that we are kind of involved with have a lot going on during Holy Week as well. So if you'd like to see what it is that they are doing and what is happening in our community, there should be a booklet at the Welcome Center that gives you an idea of all the different things that are happening. One thing I do want to point out is Westminster Presbyterian has invited us to their Light Shines in the Darkness cantata on Palm Sunday at 4 p.m. And the event is free, but they would like you to register so that they know how many are coming. And I think that's all I have. Kids will be dismissed after passing of the peace. And if you would rise as you feel led, we'll have another song.
I am not skilled to understand what God has willed, but God has planned. Take him at his word and deed. Christ died to save me, this I read. And in my heart I find a need of him to be my Savior. That he would leave sinful Savior's always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God is always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God is always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God is always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God is always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior loves, my Savior loves, my Savior loves.
Have a seat and good morning. Life's storms often overwhelm us, and fear and uncertainty take their toll. When this happens, it's easy to forget that we are beloved children of God. When we run away from our problems, we discover that we cannot run away from ourselves. Yet God is present with us to hear our confession and offer forgiveness. God brings us back to face what we have left behind, so that we may embrace the promise of reconciliation and wholeness. The power of death leaves us shaken and afraid. But God in Christ calls us out of our fear to experience a presence that offers eternal hope and peace. Please join me in the corporate prayer of confession. Holy God, we come to you asking for your mercy and grace. Forgive us for the times we have ignored the needs of others in favor of our own desires. Forgive us for the times we have kept our blessings for ourselves rather than sharing with those around us. Forgive us for the times we have not held our leaders accountable for the unjust systems we live in. Creator God, in your mercy, guide us back to paths of justice and peace. Amen. Now let us take a moment of silence to have an honest conversation with God. Family of faith, though we may have work to do to repair our relationships, we can rest in the assurance we are forgiven by God. Like the growth of a forest rising from ashes, our world is made to renew life. Begin again, knowing there is healing and restoration to be found in the living water of Jesus. Thanks be to God. Peace be with you.
And
wave to the cameras over here and wherever the rest of them are, because they're watching you. Take a few moments to greet those in the room, and when you hear the music, it's time to get back to your chair.
It's always too quick.
Amen. Please be seated. Please be seated. Our scripture this morning comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 21, verses 18 through 22. We're going to skip ahead a little bit. This actually happens during what we would refer to as Holy Week, on like a Monday or Tuesday of Holy Week. So just wrap that in your brain as you listen to the scripture. Listen now for what the Gospel of Matthew has for you this morning. In the morning, when he returned to the city, he was hungry. And seeing a fig tree by the side of the road, he went to it and found nothing at all on it but leaves. Then he said to it, "May no fruit ever come from you again." And the fig tree withered at once. When the disciples saw it, they were amazed, saying, "How did the fig tree wither at once?" Jesus answered him, "Truly I tell you, if you have faith and no doubt, and do not doubt, not only will you do what has been done to the fig tree, but even if you say to this mountain, 'Be lifted up and thrown into the sea,' it will be done. Whatever you ask for in prayer, with faith you will receive." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us now reflect on Scripture with a song. Amen. 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 Let us pray. Dear Lord, let the words of my mouth and the meditations of each and every one of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. This week, we continue our series called This Is My Body. Today, we're reminded that Jesus got hungry. And every time I read this scripture, I think, come on, Jesus, calm down. What did that fig tree do to you? Now, both of our devotions, the family-oriented one and the one geared towards less coloring, posit that Jesus might not only have been hungry, but in his hunger, he might have become hangry. Do you know this term, hangry? It's when you get hungry, and because of your hunger, it makes you less than your best self. You can get snippy or salty, you can say things you may not mean, and you can be hurtful to others. Now, this is actually a result of low blood sugar, or your blood sugar dropping. When your blood sugar drops to a certain level, you get hungry, and as a type 1 diabetic who has had a few low blood sugars over the years, I can tell you that I am not often at my best self when I'm low. This is one of those stories of Jesus that I can totally relate to. And it totally makes sense that Jesus would be hungry, agitated, maybe even a little cranky. He's had a big couple of days. In the timeline of this story, we've jumped ahead, as I said, a little. The story occurs after Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem, after he has cleansed the temple and flipped tables. This photo came across my feed, I don't know where, but when AI was told to represent Jesus flipping over tables in the temple, this is what we got. Also, our wonderful communications coordinator, Ashley, was playing with AI a little bit about Jesus being hungry. So we have white Jesus eating McDonald's. Pizza, it's sort of like a Detroit kind of thing. Really digs those fries. Do you know why McDonald's fries are better? They have sugar on them. That's why they do it. So Jesus has flipped tables. So after he has cleansed the temple, and in some stories he's using a cat of nine tails and he's whipping people and flipping tables. This is one of my favorite stories of Jesus because we have this picture. The American church has this picture of Jesus as this very calm Buddhist monk, and he's not. He is aggressive at times. But you can see why Jesus might have been a little agitated and a little hungry. The day after the flipping of the tables is where we find ourselves in this story. And I totally think that this reading as Jesus just being hangry and lashing out when the fig tree did not have fruit as expected is a reasonable reading of the story. I also wonder about how we respond when our expectations are unmet, especially when we are in an agitated state, when we are hungry or tired or anxious, basically any time we're not well-rested and well-fed. Sounds like most of the time for me. I don't know about you. I'm hungry right now, actually. There's an expectation that this tree would have figs. It has leaves. Why wouldn't it have figs? Jesus is hungry. He knows he's coming to the culmination of his ministry. Oh, yeah, so many scholars believe that Jesus knows what's coming in a few days. Might put you on edge, maybe? He's had an aggressive encounter at the temple, and he's hungry. And it doesn't seem that he's running on all cylinders, which is a mechanical joke that doesn't make sense if you drive an electric car. His expectations are not met, and he has a human moment. Now, I've read commentaries from all kinds of places, and frankly, I didn't find a lot of helpful information. I found a lot of words trying to make sense of why what Jesus did makes total sense and glorifies God or shows us that if we have faith, we'll be able to pronounce withering judgment or move mountains. You know, either or. This scripture has also been used to contrast between fruitless Judaism and fruitful Christianity. In fact, many have used this scripture to say that the Christians are a replacement for the Jews. Much of my study reminded me of sometimes we, the church, get so caught up in the way that we want it to be, that sometimes we can be harmful and even deadly. When the scripture says things that go against our expectations or assumptions, we do our best to wrap a lot of words around it to make it seem holy and faithful or right. And to be honest, I don't think the church is the only group that does this. In fact, I think we all do it to some degree. Paint ourselves in the best light when we maybe have a human moment or have a moment that doesn't represent us as well as we might like. We have feelings and we have emotions, and those produce actions. And then we try to make sense of them by wrapping words around them. Now, part of it is cultural, part of it is spiritual, part of it is the way our brains work. But a lot of times when we lash out, it's a result of our own stuff rather than the stuff around us. Have you ever heard the statement, "They made me do it"? They forced my hand. In our world, in our relationships, there are always things that are acting upon us. Things that are affecting us, things that are shaping our daily lives. And we also have some control of how we might engage those things. My spiritual director says you can control yourself and the 5 feet around you. And you're lucky if you get 5 feet. Our ability to make healthy and fruitful decisions is often based on our history, our experiences, our culture, our surroundings, and maybe even if we're hungry or not. Can you think of a time where you lashed out with a withering stare or withering barb, yelling, or maybe even violence? Can you just give you a second if you can think of maybe one or two pop straight to your brain? Did it feel good? Probably. Did it solve the problem? I doubt it. Did it make it worse? Do you think you could have handled that differently? There are several times in my life when I have had to go make amends after a low blood sugar. And to be honest, sometimes I blame the low blood sugar. When I wasn't actually low, I was just annoyed. I like to blame the sugar for my snarky comments. And don't get me wrong, my low blood sugar had an impact on the resources I had available to me at the time. But oftentimes, I was the only one that knew I was low. The person or people I was with didn't know that I was low or what I was going through. They might not have even known I was diabetic. Sometimes, I didn't even know my blood sugar was low until after the fact. They ended up being on a receiving end of my lashing, totally unexpectedly. Our Lenten devotional tells us that people in recovery from addiction often use the halt tool as a reminder to check in with their bodies and assess their own well-being before they act. HALT is an acronym for hungry, angry, lonely, and tired. Some people have reminders set on their devices to assess these conditions throughout the day. Some people keep a diary recording these states. Some ask friends to check in with them if they're starting to get upset or not feeling quite themselves. For people in recovery, these states can be dangerous because they may lead to relapse. But for all of us, when we're not paying attention to what our bodies are needing or asking for, we can do damage to ourselves and those around us. Parents of young children probably learn this quickly. If their baby or toddler is fussy, it's often because they haven't gotten a nap in yet, or because they want to nurse or have a snack. If you're like me, this meant that I had bags of Cheerios or granola bars stashed in the car, in bags, in jackets, random places around the house. Now that I think about it, maybe I should start doing that again. Because lack of sleep or sustenance can swing my kids and my mood in significant ways. Our devotional continues. It says, the scripture tells us that Jesus was hungry, and when the fig tree didn't offer what he had hoped for, what he expected, he destroyed it. The disciples were amazed and were reminded, and we are reminded of other occasions in scripture where amazed is partnered with afraid to describe their reaction to something. And something Jesus has done, like on the boat when he spoke the storm and the stillness, which we read not too long ago. Jesus waking up from a nap and stilling a storm. There's power in Jesus' words and actions, and they're not quite sure how to understand it. Maybe they learn to carry granola bars after this, just in case. Jesus' short speech here is intriguing. I wonder if he knew what would happen to the fig tree when he spoke those words. I wonder if it was surprised at the effect his words had. I wonder if his statement to the disciples, whatever you ask for, you will receive, was spoken as a promise or a warning, or maybe both. Or maybe he was processing out loud what they'd all just witnessed. Mark's version of this story, the Gospel of Mark version of this story, but not in our reading today, tells us that there are no figs on the trees because it was not the season for figs. If Jesus had paused to assess his own state, his own hunger or anger or loneliness or tiredness, I wonder if he would have had more consideration for the season of the fig tree. I wonder if deeper awareness might lead all of us toward more compassionate treatment of others and the other lives around us. I was talking with my spiritual director this week, and we were talking about the practice of self-compassion. This practice, which I'm just learning about, is a practice that invites you to turn inward, to self-assess, to recognize when you are activated, when your body is responding. The goal is that by coming to love and understand yourself and why you might be responding in the way that you do, you embrace all parts of you, those that are maybe in less health, and help move them to more health. You seek to heal them with the help of God and your community. This healing and inward turning allows you to understand yourself, to love yourself. It's not self-critique. It's self-compassion. Passion with. This inward turning to love ultimately make you more able to give and receive love from others. This self-compassion allows you to be more open to life, more gracious to others, and hopefully live more fully into who God has created you to be. Every day, I'll say it later, but every Sunday we say, God looks down upon each and every one of you and says, beloved, with you I am well pleased. That comes from our scripture, and when Jesus is asked what the greatest commandment is, he says, to love God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind. And the second is like it, to love your neighbor as yourself. I would argue that we do that second part really well. Hear me clearly. I think we do that second part really well because we do not love ourselves well. So often in our world, self-love becomes self-centeredness or narcissism. It turns inward and it stays inward. This idea of self-compassion, this idea of recognizing when you're hungry, when you're activated, when that moment, that smell reminds you of your mother, when that words remind you of that time that bully said that thing to you in sixth grade, and you are immediately back there. To recognize and to know those things allows you to turn in and to go through. You move through the self into the openness that God has created, the community that God has surrounded us with, the birds and the trees and the blossoms and all of our atoms that are constantly humming. Friends, when we can take a moment and notice just for a second what's going on with us, what's activating us, it helps us to respond to all, respond to the we in our world. That doesn't mean closing the doors and locking us away from every other person. It means doing our work so that we may be a blessing and provide fruit to those around us and see the fruit in our own lives. As you live into God, who God has created, remember that we all get tired, we all get hungry, we all have stuff. And it just might mean that God loves every bit of us. And how we react to those things is how we show our fruits of the Spirit. Doesn't mean you're always nice, but hopefully you're kind. Hopefully you always feel loved. May it be so, and amen. Let us pray. Loving God, because you created all people to need healthy food, and because you love all people, we pray today for those who do not have access to food. We pray for places where weather patterns have caused drought and famine. We pray for places where locusts have destroyed crops and lives. We pray for places where food is too expensive or too far away. Have mercy on humankind that we might find ways to feed everyone. Convict the hearts of those who have access to extra and those who hoard resources for the sake of the few, and convict our hearts so we might make healthy food more accessible in our community. Amen. Please rise as you feel led and join us in our next song.
Be seated. Join me now in the prayers of the people. Holy and loving Lord, we come to you today with all our joys, all of our sorrows, and every piece of who we are. We cry out for your mercy and we seek your guidance for our lives. Lead us further into the path of righteousness, love, and justice. Mighty God, you rescue us when we are drowning. You shield us when we are attacked. You hold back the winds when life is too chaotic. And you silence our enemies when we cannot bear to hear another unkind word. We call upon your might to confront the power of rulers, kings, CEOs, and patriarchs. Let the hungry be fed and the oppressed go free. Let the laborer be fairly compensated and the voices of the marginalized be heard. Let us hear your call to action when we see injustice and suffering in the world around us. Gentle Spirit, you comfort us in our grief. You speak truth to us when we are desperate. You guide our hearts when we drift away from relationship, and you call us toward healing when we have been traumatized. We call upon your gentle kindness to disrupt the anxious thoughts of the fearful, to infuse hope into the minds of the self-loathing, to grant peaceful sleep to the exhausted, and to quiet the critical voices within and around us. Help us to be a place of welcome and compassion. Let us be a community that shows that each person is your beloved child by the way we treat our neighbors. God of creation, even as we pray for all of these things, we give you thanks for all of the many blessings in our lives. We give thanks for both the sunshine and the rain, for the new growth that we can see around us. We give thanks for our loved ones, for our family and friends, and the journeys we share together. We give thanks for your light that leads us ever forward into hope, joy, love, and peace. We pray these things not in our own power, but in the name and power of the one who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Jesus is the light of the world and the fount of every blessing. May you be restored, renewed, and transformed to face the inevitable storms which arise. Please join us in one last song of worship.
Your love never changes.
is far too wide. I never thought I'd reach the other side. Your love never fails. You stay the same through the ages. Your love never changes. There may be pain in the night, but joy comes in the morning.
Amen, amen, amen. One of the things that I believe about the Bible is the Bible tells a true story. And it tells a story that helps us, and it is all of the stories are helpful for correction and for knowledge and for love and for instruction. Now, this particular story in the Bible, for me, is problematic because it doesn't make sense to who I know Jesus to be. And I don't want to try to make it make sense to who Jesus, I know Jesus to be. What I want to do is I want to say, maybe Jesus was also human. Doesn't make him bad, doesn't make his message and his truth less. It just means that sometimes people get hungry and they lash out. Even Jesus. So when someone that you know, someone that you have had a deep relationship with, does something that seems slightly out of character, doesn't fit with what you know them to be, maybe there's something going on. Maybe it's not because they're awful and they have been lying to you your whole relationship. But maybe you feel that because you have had that happen to you. Friends, life is hard. Relationships are difficult and people aren't perfect. And when we add anxiety and hunger and fear and loneliness and depression and world war on top of that, we often aren't at our best selves. There's a meme that goes around all the time that says, remember, everyone you meet today is dealing with something. And so are you. And every single day, God looks down upon each and every one of you and says, beloved, with you I am well pleased. Know that in here, feel that in here, and live that where you are, because there will be days where you wither fig trees. Or you want to. And maybe it's not a fig tree, maybe it's a politician or your neighbor. But remember, no matter what, you are loved, and so are they. And that let's make the they become a we by sharing love with ourselves and with one another. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all now and forever. And go get some cookies. Amen.